Let me welcome you all to this program, which is primarily there to discuss about the teaching learning process associated with the particular subject, which is very common and popular amongst the engineering and science community, that is fluid mechanics. So, I have to emphasize here that this is not a regular course in fluid mechanics. So, the paradigm of this course is essentially conceptual foundations in fluid mechanics or fundamental concepts in fluid mechanics. As teachers, I presume that those who are listening to these lectures are also teachers, at least most of them are teachers. So, as teachers, we are also learners, and there has been a long history of our learning process before we have become teachers. So, I can remember that when I was a student, I also learned a subject called as fluid mechanics, and we had excellent teachers who used to teach us this particular subject and other applied subjects related to this. Nevertheless, what I realized later on is that the understanding of the subject as a teacher and the understanding of the subject as, say, an undergraduate student is completely in a different plane. So, when we were students, the end objective was to get marks in the exam. I mean, just in a jokingly fashion, some of our professors used to say that, you know, there are two types of students. One is fundamentalist and another is Marxist. So, the fundamentalist student always is careful about, you know, what are the fundamentals, fundamental concepts and all this. Marxist, quote unquote, is not the Marxist in the real sense, but a student who wants to get marks, like grades and all those things. And it is important that we give a due recognition to these two needs combined together. And that is a very challenging thing, because as a student, we were confronted with many questions. These questions remained unanswered. What we were mostly happy with is developing an ability to answer the questions of the exams, because that is how we were assessed and that is how we were graded. Eventually, what turned out is that when we grew up as teachers, we found that there are certain lacunae or lapses in conceptual understanding as we have evolved from our student life to our teacher life. And I believe that this course is about bridging this gap. That is, some discussion that will permit us to evolve smoothly from a student mindset to a teacher mindset. And now, what I will do is, in the introductory lecture, I will not actually enter into fluid mechanics. What I will do is, I will discuss about some pedagogical issues. These are issues which are basically associated with teaching learning process, and how these issues are important. These are true for most of the subjects, but equally true for fluid mechanics. So, these are some points which we will touch upon. Like, the first is challenges in the Google era. So, the present era is very much different from the era that most of us as students passed through. When we were students, you know, this kind of dramatic advent of internet and communication technology, smartphone, all these things, I mean, these were unbelievable things in our daily life. So, only things that we had for our education were good books and good teachers and notes of good teachers. These were the things available. And many times what used to happen is that the teaching learning process was therefore not that challenging how as compared to what it is now. I mean, as students we used to make a joke, make certain jokes that, you know, there were professors who used to carry class notes year after year, same class note. When the note will become yellow in color, the teacher will take this to a photocopy shop. Once it is taken to a photocopy shop, it will again become white, and the same thing will be cycled year after year. In terms of the teaching style, we had some teachers, I mean in the old university system, there were teachers with designations as lecturer, reader, professor. Nowadays, the designations in the Indian universities are different. I mean, there are like it starts with assistant professor and so on, but I mean this was a university system once upon a time. So, people used to say that the lecturers who are the youngest ones will actually strive very hard and prepare the lesson and, you know, very faithfully reproduce whatever they have studied and delivered that in the class. Reader is a little bit senior person, so does not prepare that well. So, reader will read from the book, that is why the name reader. And professor is like, you know, somebody who is at the top will give some, you know, gyan type of thing to people, and you know it is up to the students to take it further forward. So, all these things were in a joking mood that, you know, maybe many of you also have such discussions with your friends and colleagues. But the thing is that, you know, when you are talking about the Google era, whatever you are going to say, immediately the student can get related information in the internet, maybe through mobile phone which they are already carrying in the class, or maybe outside the class in their computer, they can easily get this information. So, question is, what more will you give? If you cannot give more, you cannot create an impact to the class. Gone are those old days when this huge amount of information was not accessible to the students. So, that is a big challenge, and the answer to this is very simple. You give some interpretation in between lines which are not normally there as recorded material in the textbook or in the web material. The next point is, I will just touch upon these points which are flashed on the screen, teach and don't preach. This is very important. I will give one example in the context of fluid mechanics. In fluid mechanics, we often talk about a boundary condition called as no slip boundary condition. That means, fluid does not slip over the solid boundary. So, you know, in your undergraduate classes, this will be normally faithfully described as something, you know, which is observed in experiments. Therefore, this has to be obeyed. Now, what is not mentioned is that there is nothing fundamental that precludes one to, you know, make a inference that that also could be possible. There are many advanced experiments which have reported slip. So, it is a question that needs to be addressed carefully instead of just accepting that, you know, that no slip boundary condition is something that works. Therefore, nothing has to be taken as granted. As a teacher, never try to preach. Just try to discuss things with your students, and if there is something which is unbelievable to a student from a normal intuitive logic, try to accept that carefully. The next point is, motivation and learning objectives must be cleared. So, Let us say in the next class I will be starting with some topics, say kinematics of flow. No, now I can straight away say let us consider a particle moving in a flow and all those things, that is a way of doing it. But if I spend a little bit of time, you know, what I am going to talk about, what is its importance and how it helps in understanding the subject, I think it develops a mindset of what you expect out of the teaching. And the next thing is that these days there are many teachers who love to use gadgets, you know, and there are good and bad things about it, and I will discuss about that in the next point. But most important thing is that good teaching requires an excellent grasp on the fundamentals. So if you do not have a good grasp on the fundamentals, please try to make sure that that is made as airtight as possible, because without that you cannot be an effective teacher. No matter whether the subject is fluid mechanics or anything else, the first and foremost requirement is you yourself should have a good grasp. The next question is of course how you deliver, how you communicate and all those things. Then the next point is refrain from overuse and abuse of modern gadgets. So I can remember that long time back when I started my journey as a teacher in our IIT system, I used to teach undergraduate fluid mechanics course. And just informally, I took some opinion from the students in the class that what kind of mode of teaching would be most befitting to their interest. Is it a PowerPoint based presentation based lecturing, or board chalk and talk based traditional teaching? Believe me or not, these are all students of the modern era, and they said that in a mathematical topic like this, they would hate to have a class with PowerPoint presentations and, you know, presenting the mathematical things in a nice flashy way one after the other. Of course, you should not take this as a granted opinion from students. The reason is that there are many aspects where nice videos or nice pictures, which are, you know, difficult to create as an environment in the board, if you present that through your presentation, that can create a big impact. So the question is not whether using the traditional chalk and talk is better, or the use of the slides as a teaching medium that is better. Actually, there is no hard and fast rule about it, there is no definite answer about it, but sometimes you should not be tempted to overuse the gadgets, when actually if you go through the details in the board, it can create a more impactful environment in the mind of the students. So that is my own experience. Some people may differ from that, but that is what I feel. Inspirational and thought provoking discussion. So in any discussion, you know, most of the times as teachers we say that these are things which are there as the subject material, and we faithfully deliver that. Very often we discuss about things which are already done, and we faithfully reproduce that in the class, and that is what we are supposed to do, that is our job as a teacher, and that is why we are paid. But hardly we talk about, you know, certain open questions, unsolved problems in the domain which you are talking about, and that can be very, very critical, because that can actually open up the imagination of the mind of an inquisitive student, that, you know, this is where challenge lies, this is where, say, in fluid mechanics many problems remain to be unsolved, and that can actually motivate a good student. Entertain questions. This is very important. Many times as teachers we have a tendency to think that this question is a foolish question, this question is a bad question. So, nothing, there is nothing called as a foolish question. Questions might come to the mind in a spontaneous way. You are being told certain things, as a response to that certain questions may evolve in the mind, and you should not just, you know, underrate that question as you know some irrelevant question. Try to answer it. If the answer is not very convincing and if you yourself is not convinced or not convinced about this, you just tell that, you know, I will think about it and try to give an honest better answer in the next day. Like, nobody expects that you are like, you know, possibly like Professor Einstein, who has answer to all questions in science. So, I mean, you have your own limitations, all of us have our own limitations. Maybe we have learnt a subject in a nice way, but one particular aspect we have never thought of. A student is reminding you of that, so take it very sportingly and positively. Respect the needs of the student. So, when we talk about a subject, sometimes we are very philosophical, right? I mean, we tend to discuss about things in our own style, but you know, a student may have a different perspective in mind. Maybe the student is looking for a job, and because the student is looking for a job, the student is looking for some clues in that particular subject which helps him or her to become more confident in appearing for the job interview. Respect that. Do not disrespect that and think that is irrelevant. Imagine that once upon a time we were also students and we passed through the same phase, right? We also needed jobs for our livings and all those things, and these are not, you know, irrational thoughts of life. Do not merely reproduce textbook materials but interpret between lines. This is what I have already mentioned. Balance of delivery styles between interactive and narrative. So, something which you go on talking which is very narrative style, but you also can have interactive style. Incidentally, because this is a distance mode video course, so interaction is going to be limited, but we will try to find out opportunities where I would like to personally interact with all the participants in this SWAYAM program. I can understand it is a huge number of participants, but I would personally like to interact with all of you as individuals. Then give examples from day to day life to create interest and develop knowledge. See, drawing similarity between common life example and a very complex concept in physics and mathematics is an art. It needs to be developed with practice, and if you want to be an effective teacher, particularly in a subject like fluid mechanics, which is flooded with concepts of physics and mathematics, you will realize that if you can draw such analogies, then it will be more meaningful and attractive. Towards the end of this introductory lecture, I will give you one or two examples to illustrate that how you can give examples to give concept. Then the next point is that highlight on possible misconception on critical topics. So, when we teach a particular course, again this is an art. If we bring ourselves back to our own student life, we can imagine that these could be certain points or certain areas where significant doubts could be created, and then possibly similar doubts are already being created in the minds of the students who are attending your lecture, or these doubts will invariably be created if they go through the study material. So, try to anticipate those doubts. and try to clear those misconceptions. For example, in fluid mechanics, a very common misconcept is that incompressible flow means density equal to constant. So, this is only a partial reality of the complete set of incompressible flows. So, now this is something which, if it is not hammered to the minds of the student, it will remain as a lacuna in the conceptual understanding forever. So, as a teacher, I think this is a big responsibility. And the final point to note before I get on to the examples is that there cannot be a bad student, there can only be a bad teacher. So, as teachers, you know, we always tend to behave as dominating personalities, because the grades of the student depend on us. So, then we eventually say, you know, this student is a bad student and this student X is even worse, something like this. So, if there is a bad student, what does it mean actually is that a part of the responsibility is there on you also. If the student is seriously attending the class and still the student appears to be a bad student, that means you possibly did not take sufficient initiative to motivate the student. So, that may be because you yourself have a poor communication skill, maybe you have good knowledge, but you have poor communication skill, or maybe you have good communication skill, but you have poor knowledge, and the worst thing is you have a combination of the two, that is poor communication skill and very poor knowledge, and then it is not good to dump all the responsibilities to the student. So, do not bother so much about, you know, irrelevant things like, you know, some student speaking a little bit in the class, maybe, you know, doing a little bit thing, maybe chatting with a phone, smartphone, with using WhatsApp with his friend. Most of the times as teachers, these things actually do not disturb us much, but because we are egoistic, we take this badly. So, let these things happen. I mean, these are parts of life. Like when we were students, we were not like gods and goddesses sitting in the class, right? That needs to be clearly understood. So, then as I told that I will wind up this particular lecture with two examples. The first example is about concept of averaging. So, what is concept of averaging? It is very important. I will not go through this in the fluid mechanics course as a whole, because this is continuum fluid mechanics that we are going to talk about. But essentially, when you consider fluid as a continuum, the underlying picture is a molecular picture. So, you have molecular level information, say velocity of individual molecules, and you combine these together or average that in some sense, so that molecular velocity is upscaled to fluid velocity. So, you say velocity of fluid at a point, right? At a point, when you say velocity of fluid, it is a culmination of averaging over maybe a number of molecules in some statistical sense. So, question is, how will you do the averaging? So, to give a concept of, you know, how this averaging can succeed or fail, this is a nice example where there is a professor who has joined an university, a young professor, and the professor has the liberty of teaching two types of students. One is a student of intellect 3 out of 3, like Professor Einstein, it cannot be more than that, and a student not so genius. You can look at the faces of these two students, which are there in front of your screen, and you will realize from the face appearance that what is the level of intellect. So, the level of intellect of this student is 1. So, now this professor has 3 semesters of teaching, first semester, second semester and third semester. In the first semester, so there is only one class, one student in the class and that student appears to be as intelligent as Professor Einstein. When there is only one student in the class, there is some probability that that student can be a genius. So, this professor is extremely pleased because the average intellect of the student in his class is 3. In the next semester, you know, there are quite a few number of students, and then you know when the numbers grow up, you will not turn out to be that lucky, and in this semester you know all the students are dull. So called, I mean I should not say bad student because I have myself made a comment that there cannot be a bad student. So the average is 1. Then in the third semester, you know, luck has become little bit balancing. So, one student with intellect 3, another student with intellect 1, so the average intellect is 2. So, semester wise, first semester average 3, second semester average 1, third semester average 2. So, the question is that you know, essentially the teacher has taught 16 students in 3 semesters and total value of intellect is 2 times the genius and 14 times the ordinary student. So, the question is how do you estimate the intellect of the average student? So, if it is asked now that what is the average intellect of the student that whom you have taught? So, one way is average value of for the 3 semesters, 3 plus 1 plus 2 divided by 3, that is 2. The other is cumulative average over all students. So, what you do is that you find out the total intellect divided by the total number of students. So, 2 into 3 plus 14 into 1 divided by 16, this becomes 1.25. So, clearly you see that depending on the method of averaging, the estimation of the intellect of the average student, this estimation differs, I mean the percentage deviation is significant, 2 and 1.25 these are grossly different predictions. So, why it is so? It is so because there is a correlation between the class size and the quality of students in the class, and this kind of correlation if it is there, then this kind of situation is not fit enough to give you a meaningful average by these methods. So, this is the lesson that you can learn from this example. I will talk about a second example before we call it a day for this particular lecture. This is regarding principle of conservation. Why I want to give it this as a prelude to my lectures is because in fluid mechanics, principle of conservation is very important. We are talking about conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, conservation of energy, all these things we are talking about, right. So, now the entire act of writing or developing or deriving differential equations in fluid mechanics is about explaining or expressing these fundamental principles in terms of the derivatives, first order, second order, whatever. When you are teaching a young student, if you start with these derivatives, sometimes it can, you know, it can, the student can lose the track and can lose the interest. Moreover, nowadays it is not so easy to motivate a student, you know, in such a fundamental scientific subject. Students are, you know, students are in a different plane altogether. Now, people are more interested in machine learning than, you know, human learning. So, the entire job of a teacher is different. So, this is an example that I give, and I mean I will not go through the slide, but I will explain this, what example that I normally give. That, well, balance of mass, momentum, energy is not so intuitive to understand, but money balance is something which excites all of us. So let us say that somebody has got a job and has gone to a bank to open a bank account. So some money is deposited in the bank account and then the bank account starts. Then every month the salary is deposited to the bank, and then the person, after maybe a few months, when the balance in the pocket is not sufficient, intends to withdraw some money from the bank. I mean, earlier times people used to physically go to the bank, now it is the ATM where they will withdraw the money from. And surprisingly, the person sees that, you know, there was some money put in the bank account to open the bank, then some money has come in the form of a salary. So, and some money is withdrawn, but the balance is more than that. Until and unless there is a fraud who has worked on the, you know, magnetic part of the debit card or whatever and created a mess of the system. Otherwise, you will surprisingly see that, you know, there is some more money than what entered into and what came out. And this is a source or generation which is because of the bank interest that the bank gives you. So money in minus money out plus money generated due to interest is the net accumulation of money in your bank account. So if you look into this slide, you see the balance law is in minus out plus generated is equal to change, right? And then instead of this money, it could be mass, momentum, energy, species, whatever, and each of these can give rise to a beautiful unified paradigm of how to look into fluid mechanics. So fluid mechanics is a beautiful subject. I hope that this discussion on teaching learning process will be enjoyable to you as we evolve. Thank you very much for so far as this lecture is concerned. In the next lecture, we will start with the kinematics of flow. Thank you very much.